This week, Tom Hanks is stranded on a deserted island in Castaway.
Michael Douglas and Catherine Zeta-Jones are on opposite sides of the drug wars in Traffic.
And ad exec Mel Gibson finds it's a blessing and a curse to know what women want.
Tom Hanks stretches his physical and emotional survival skills to the absolute limit when he's marooned on a remote island in Castaway, one of six new movies we'll be reviewing this week. I'm Roger Ebert, film critic for the Chicago Sun-Times.
And I'm Richard Roper, columnist for the Chicago Sun-Times. Castaway stars Tom Hanks as Chuck Noland, a systems engineer for Federal Express who survives when a company plane crashes but winds up stranded on a South Pacific island with little hope of being rescued. Some FedEx packages have also washed up, and one box contains a volleyball that he nicknames Wilson.
That's a search area of 500,000 square miles. It's twice the size of Texas. But they may never find us.
The pudgy Chuck has few outdoor skills, but he finally succeeds in his quest for fire, leading to a rare moment of joy on the island. After 4 years, Chuck has been transformed into a lean survivalist, but he's losing his grip on reality. He debates Wilson about his plan to make a raft.
We might just make it. Did that thought ever cross your brain? Well, regardless, I would rather take my chance out there on the ocean than to stay here and die on this island, spending the rest of my life talking to a volleyball!
Tom Hanks is one of the few actors with the vision, the guts, and the clout to make such a movie that includes a one-hour stretch with almost no dialogue and no music, not to mention that weird volleyball sidekick. Director Robert Zemeckis shows his flair particularly in the sequences at sea, and the script from William Broyles Jr. is a minimalist gem, but it's the astonishing performance by Hanks that makes Castaway a unique standout.
I liked it, too. I liked his performance. I liked the chances that he took. I liked the scenes on the island and the survivalist stuff that he did. And I approve of the film. I'm giving it a thumbs up.
Okay.
What I didn't like, I almost don't want to mention, because I don't want to give away things that, in fact, all of the ads and all of the trailers are very much determined to give away. I don't want to get into that. It just seems to me, though, that there is a part of the film that never really delivers on the intended level, and you know what part that is.
You don't like the way the story resolves itself. Let's just leave it at that. And I agree with you. I mean, not to review the ad campaign, but I wish they hadn't given away all that.
Uh-huh.
But it's a risk-taking role. You know, Tom Hanks is so familiar to us. He's one of the most recognizable people on the planet, yet he loses himself in the character, and we really do sympathize with him through this long adventure on the island.
And I think that maybe the adventure on the island was the film, and the sandwich on either end was kind of unnecessary, and I don't want to go into any more than that.
I think it was necessary, but maybe the way it resolved itself, not perfect.
Okay. Next movie. What do women want was Freud's most famous question, and Mel Gibson tries to answer it in What Women Want, a movie including his attempts to personally test makeup, pantyhose, and depilatory strips, all to find out a way to market new products to women. He gets a big advantage when a bolt of electricity gives him the ability to read women's minds. At the ad agency where he works, Helen Hunt is the woman who got the job he desperately wanted and thought he deserved, and he flirts by responding to her thoughts.
Hi.
Hi. Well, you've been here 5 minutes. Looks like you've been here a year.
Oh, yeah. I'm compulsive. It's the problem. Why do I always feel like he's checking me out? I wonder what he's got up his sleeve.
Great photographs.
No clue they're all Margaret Burke-White.
They're not all Margaret Burke-White.
Another woman in his life is Marissa Tomei, who works in a coffee shop. He has her number, too.
I can't take no for an answer.
About what?
About what? About us.
Just don't hurt me, Nick. I've been hurt too many times.
I know how hard it is to go out with someone new. I mean, there's always that fear of, well, getting hurt.
Mel Gibson has been voted the sexiest man alive, and while I think that such votes should be counted and counted and counted again, it is amazing that What Women Want is his first full-out romantic comedy. He works well here with Hunt in a farce involving office politics and their love affair. Their timing is perfect in the mind-reading scenes. I had a little trouble, though, with the way he treats Marissa Tomei. He's kind of mean to her. And a subplot that I didn't like involved a dreary file clerk that brings the movie to a complete halt. Still, I enjoyed What Women Want a lot, and when it was rolling, it was funny.
Yeah, it's a silly movie. I mean, I lived in Chicago my whole life. I've never been hit with bolts of electricity, and it happens to Mel Gibson right. About every half hour in the story, because it has to for the story to develop. Yeah. But, you know, this kind of actually reminded me of Tootsie, where you have a guy who's kind of a jerk and only gets to relate to women after he gets, you know, with Dustin Hoffman, he tried on the clothes and became a character. In this case, he can hear, Mel Gibson can hear what women are thinking about him, and much to his shock, he's not the charming guy he thinks he is. They think of him as a womanizing pig. His daughter's embarrassed by him. Almost everybody thinks he's a jerk. Yeah. And he does grow and learn. And I think one of the key things in this movie is the performance by the actresses, not just Helen Hunt, but Marissa Tomei, some of the women who have smaller roles, because everything they have to do with their face and a voiceover. They're not speaking the lines. They're thinking this stuff. And there are some really, really funny lines in this movie.
That's right. It was directed by Nancy Meyer, who was involved in Private Benjamin and the Father of the Bride. She knows a lot about these male-female issues. There's one great scene where he's making love, and you think, well, if you know what a woman is thinking while you're making love, that makes you a great lover, right? He finds out what she's really thinking is Britney Spears on Leno tonight?
Yeah.
I mean, moments like that are really, it's a very funny movie.
You know, this is a good date movie, but I don't know what's going to happen after the date with a lot of couples after that.
Coming up later in the show, Michael Douglas fights the war on drugs in Washington. And at home is Steven Soderbergh's Traffic.
We're going after their top guys.
Your government surrendered this war a long time ago.
Coming up next, Sean Connery is a reclusive writer in Finding Forrester.
My name is William Forrester. I'm not one up there.
Come on, man. You got something for me?
Souffle, baby!
Sean Connery is a recluse who, from his window, keeps watch on his neighborhood in Finding Forrester, a film that celebrates the art of writing and the bonds of friendship. Echoing the personality of J.D. Salinger, Connery's character, William Forrester, wrote one great novel in the early 50s, but then he virtually disappeared. Rob Brown plays Jamal Wallace, a basketball star whose potential as a writer is so exhilarating he breaks through to Forrester. They become pals.
They got some contest at school, this writing thing. You ever entered one of those?
Writing contest?
Yeah.
Once. A long time ago.
Did you win?
Well, of course I won.
Like money or something?
The Pulitzer.
The eccentric Forrester hasn't left his apartment fortress for years, but Jamal coaxes him out on his birthday.
We'd spend our summers here. And if we were lucky, the falls.
A lot of falls with those teams.
Finding Forrester has many of the same mentor-student elements of director Gus Van Sant's Good Will Hunting, and some of the final scenes reminded me of Scent of a Woman. But you know what? Those movies won gold trophies, and Forrester is every bit as good. We all know Connery can play larger than life, but it's the vulnerability he displays here that makes this a career-crowning performance. Newcomer Rob Brown excels as Jamal, and F. Murray Abraham and Anna Paquin provide stellar supporting work. Finding Forrester is a beautifully spun story about the magic of the written word and the power of friendship.
You know, I agree with you on this, and I agree with you about Rob Brown, who was in his first movie, just as Sean Connery, you know, has been an actor for 50 years, and they worked so well and so closely and warmly together. And this is the first movie I can think of about writing that is right about writing. His advice, you know, don't wait for inspiration. Start writing, and inspiration will come during the act of writing, is the only good advice I've ever heard about writing, because everybody else is always trying to plan and prepare, and that just doesn't work.
And Connery's got some great lines about how writers use their work to get women in particular. We talked recently about a movie called Pollock, and we talked about how hard it is to show painting. Well, it's even harder to show people writing and make it interesting, but this is a really well-done, as you said, depiction of the world of writing.
And a total change of pace for Sean Connery, who is, you know, I think James Bond, after all these years, people still think of him as James Bond. He's such a versatile actor.
Yep.
Coming up next, Michael Douglas gets unexpected help from Benicio del Toro in the thriller Traffic.
You worry about getting me what I want, I worry about myself.
So you pay off customs officials?
Well, you know, in Mexico, law enforcement is an entrepreneurial activity. We hire drivers with nothing to lose and throw a lot of product at the problem. Some get stopped. Enough get through. It's not difficult. Look, boys, This has worked for years.
Traffic is an ambitious new film by Steven Soderbergh, using a big canvas to paint the drug traffic from Mexico to America, from drug dealers to drug cops, from drug lords to middlemen to street pushers to addicts. Michael Douglas is one of the stars, an Ohio judge newly appointed to lead the nation's war on drugs. To his horror, he discovers that his teenage daughter, played by Erica Christensen, is a drug abuser.
Who is it? I'm going to the bathroom.
Open the damn door!
1 minute. Excuse me, I have to go to bed.
Don Cheadle and Luis Guzman play DEA agents eavesdropping on Catherine Zeta-Jones, the luxury-loving wife of a rich San Diego businessman. He has been arrested, and she's startled to learn from family lawyer Dennis Quaid where her husband's money actually comes from.
Carl is very, very good at his business.
And Benicio del Toro plays an honest Tijuana cop who gets caught in the middle between drug dealers, Mexican officials who are on the take, and the American feds. The swimming pool means it's hard to eavesdrop on their conversation.
I believe it's important that we work together, Mexico and the United States, one hand washing the other.
We agree.
So maybe you can tell me about your informants in our operations.
We thought that maybe you'd have that kind of information for us.
The movie never actually states a message, though, about drugs. It leaves that up to us. And what I got out of it is that after decades of law enforcement efforts and harsh prison sentences, drugs are still easily available and fairly cheap for anyone who wants them. The drug laws seem to work more as price supports to keep the profits up for dealers and to encourage bribes and corruption. Traffic makes the case that drugs are a critical problem in our society, and our current approaches are not working.
Well, that is the message.
Yeah.
The drugs have covered the world. There's nothing you can do about it. And, you know, this movie runs about 2.5 hours in length, mm-hmm. yet it zips by faster than a lot of 90-minute dogs because it's a great movie, and it's really three films. It's the story of what's going on in Mexico, the story of Michael Douglas playing the drug czar, and then this wealthy California couple who are high-end drug importers, as Catherine Zeta-Jones finds out about her husband. So you have all these interweaving things. They don't all have to come together because that's not how the real world is, and it's done so well. I could have watched a whole movie about any one of those three main storylines.
You know, this Steven Soderbergh, his last four films have been Out of Sight, The Limey, Aaron Brockovich, which I have problems with, but nobody else did.
Right.
And now Traffic. This guy has emerged as a major player in Hollywood, making good films. And this one, you know, oftentimes when you have all these interlocking stories, people get confused.
Yeah.
With this one, we know exactly who everybody is, exactly what's happening. We're involved in all the different stories. And they don't need to add up. Yeah. I mean, it's just like all of this is going on at the same time, and it multiplied by a million, and that's the drug
problem.
Well,
the acting is so good, too.
Yeah.
Each person carries their story right to the end. Okay, our next movie is All the Pretty Horses, starring Matt Damon as John Grady Cole, a Texas rancher in the late 40s who saddles up for Mexico. Cole and his buddy Lacey Rawlins, played by Henry Thomas, aren't looking for much more than steady work under the open skies, but they find themselves in deep trouble soon after crossing the border. One complication, Cole falls hard for the boss's daughter, Alejandra.
I knew that you would come.
I come because I thought you'd be here.
That's Penelope Cruz continuing her crossover into American movies. Their romance comes to a stunning impasse, though, when Cole and Rawlins are thrown into jail and accused of being horse thieves. Cole spills a lot of blood before he's reunited with Alejandra, who is torn between her love for Cole and the loyalty she has to her father and her disapproving aunt.
What did she say?
She said it wasn't right for you and me to be seen together. Out on the campo.
And you agreed.
Penelope Cruz might be the most photogenic actress in movies today, and she needs that presence to compete with the stunning vistas and those gorgeous wild horses. Based on the novel by Cormac McCarthy, All the Pretty Horses is directed with a raw but poetic touch by Billy Bob Thornton, who's working from an almost too tight screenplay by playwright Ted Talley. The switch from Shakespearean romance to hardscrabble prison movie creates an emotional whiplash. There should be more romance, I think, and less jail time. But I'm still giving All the Pretty Horses a strong recommendation. It's got a lot of heart.
It does have a lot of heart. It's kind of an elegiac western in which these guys go down to Mexico and find, in a way, the old west.
Right.
Not only just the vistas and the horses and the sunsets, but also the frontier justice and being thrown in jail. And
it's still the Wild West in Mexico.
Absolutely
in
no rights. Yeah. One thing I like about Ted Talley's screenplay and the way that Billy Bob Thornton handles it is they bring the words to the foreground. If you listen carefully, they don't bury the words in room atmosphere or in location atmosphere. They bring the words up and keep the noises, the wind and the trees and the river and the horse beat and so forth, in the background so that it becomes very much a dialogue-driven story, despite the fact that the visuals keep them all on this big landscape.
I think people should understand, though, with this title, All the Pretty Horses, this is not like The Horse Whisperer. It's got a lot of Shawshank Redemption in it. I mean, it's a pretty hard-bitten movie, and it does kind of send you for a jolt. I just would have liked to see a little bit more of that romance between Matt Damon and Penelope Cruz so that we believe it when they're telling each other how much they love each other.
And you have now decided that Penelope Cruz is more photogenic than Piper Perabo?
I'm as fickle as Mel Gibson.
And what about Renee Zellweger?
They could be number two and number three.
And Julia Roberts?
You know, you cannot argue against Penelope Cruz.
When we come back, Before Night Falls, the story of a Cuban poet who fought for Castro and then was persecuted by it. Our next movie is Before Night Falls, the true story of Reynaldo Arenas, based on his memoir. He was born into utter poverty in pre-Castro Cuba, ran away at 16 to fight with the rebels, and grew up to become a poet and novelist who was persecuted by Castro's police for his writing and his homosexuality. Played by Javier Bardem, he's cross-examined by a Cuban official, played here by Johnny Depp.
This book was published in France without permission of the Writers Union. Therefore, you must have had someone to smuggle it out. You didn't go to France, did you?
Depp plays a dual role in the movie, although you might not recognize him here as a transvestite in the prison where Arenas is sent.
I heard that you can get things in and out of here.
Could you carry a package for me? Of course, he denied it.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Here is Arenas late in his life in New York telling his story for a documentary film.
Aquí el estatus firmado del Departamento de Justicia es el estable. Eso quiere decir que yo desde el punto de vista legal no existo. Estoy en el aire y no tengo ningún país. No soy religioso. Soy homosexual.
Javier Bardem plays Arenas not as a heroic figure, but as a stubborn dreamer who lives his life the only way he can. The movie was directed by Julian Schnabel, the famous American painter who shows a painter's eye in the rich canvases of his visuals. This is not a rags-to-riches life. It's more like rags-to-rags, but at least Arenas lived it on his own stubborn terms.
Well, you're right. He's not a hero. He's just a very talented writer who wants to have his own personal life, but that's enough to get you thrown in jail during this particular period of time. I did like this movie. I am recommending it. I thought it lost steam in the last third once he finally makes it to the United States and gets to New York City. And it's the true circumstances of his life, and not to minimize the sickness and what happened to him, but I've seen those scenes in other movies not as good as this one that led me to believe. And I just thought it maybe could have, if it ended when he got to New York City and we just got a graphic telling us what happened after that, it would have been a much more powerful and effective film.
In a way, you make a good point, because he gets his lifeblood from Cuba. He is a Cuban.
Absolutely.
Even though the government doesn't like him and the officials throw him in jail, the life of Cuba, as recreated by Schnabel here, and he shot on location in, I think, in Mexico. He certainly didn't shoot very much in Cuba.
No, I don't think he was allowed in there.
The scene, for example, where they have that crazy scheme to get the hot air balloon and float it up through the destroyed roof of the cathedral, the street life, the nightclubs, the beach life, the stuff like this is all so real, and that's where he belongs, in a way, and that's where he gets his art.
Yeah, so a qualified recommendation. Okay, we'll be back in a moment.
Join Roger Ebert and Richard Roper on their film festival at sea, with movie screenings and lively discussions aboard the Disney Wonder Cruise Ship, sailing February 1st through 4th on the Disney Cruise Line to the Bahamas, with a stop at the island paradise Castaway Key. The Ebert and Roper Film Festival at Sea. Call your travel agent or 1-800-945-3806.
Now let's take another look at the movies we reviewed on this week's show. Two thumbs up for Tom Hanks in Castaway, two more thumbs up for Mel Gibson in What Women Want, and two more thumbs up for Finding Forrester, with good work by Sean Connery and newcomer Rob Brown. Two big thumbs up for the powerful and angry epic Traffic. Two more thumbs up for the gritty Western All the Pretty Horses. And finally, two thumbs up for the lyrical and harrowing Before Night Falls. What Women Want opens this weekend. The other five movies open over the holidays, although some of them don't go national until January. A lot of good movies here. I think the great movie in these is Traffic, one of the best movies of the year.
Yeah, you know, I think we set a record by giving 12 thumbs up on this show since we reviewed six movies. But Traffic is the one that I think is going to be on a lot of best 10 lists. I'm not giving any hints about mine, of course, although maybe it
will. Oh, yes, you are.
Yes, I am. Okay. You can learn more about our film festival at sea on our website, ebert-roper-movies.com, where you can also hear our reviews. You can also read our stuff at suntimes.com. Next week, more new movies, including 13 Days, starring Kevin Costner, and The Family Man, a holiday romance starring Nicolas Cage. That's next week, and until then, the balcony is closed.